Hello all. Today we're speaking with Mr. Hemant Aluru, co-founder at Turno. So Turno is a Bangalore-based startup which has been operating in commercial EV segment since April 2022. And the company has launched solutions to help the retail customers adopt EVs for their business needs. So welcome, Hemant. Thank you for making time for this.
Thank you, Priyakshi. Thank you. Thanks for making this happen.
Right. So first of all, I'm curious to know, both you and your co-founder Sudhindra were a part of leadership team at Zoomcar. So what were your roles there and what prompted you to start a venture in the electric vehicle space?
So my co-founder, his name is Sudhindra. And me both, as you rightly said, were part of the management team at Zoomcar. I was the chief business officer there. Sudhi was the chief operating officer there. Between both of us, we effectively manage the company's business and P&L at Zoomcar, along with the founder, Greg. One of the key reasons why we always wanted to join Zoomcar was to be able to leverage the Zoomcar business and the platform and build an electric vehicle focused business on top of it. Now, for various reasons, at Zoomcar, we've had to take different directions, and eventually we actually did have a large fleet of electric cars and electric scooters, and we did run a bunch of different business experiments to understand what business models will or will not make sense. We definitely did not see a long-term alignment in building an EV focused business within Zoomcar. And both Sudhi and I always wanted to build something in that space. And we started talking sometime during that phase where we were left at Zoomcar about doing something in the EV space. And because we were already pretty close to the ecosystem, we were one of the largest buyers of electric vehicles already. There was a point sometime in the last 18 months where it started seeming like the inflection point was arriving finally. The conversations, both policy-wise, business-wise, consumer-wise, we're all shifting very dramatically in the EV direction. We felt the time was right for us to build a EV only business where we did not have any other priorities but just putting more electric vehicles on the road, right? And putting really solving for that one mission that we were very passionate about.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and how did you zoom in on commercial three wheelers?
Three-wheelers just happen to be the products which are ready right now. So it is not more about the three-wheelers, but it is really about the commercial segment. So there are obviously, like, you could do a business both in the personal vehicle, personal mobility space, or the commercial mobility space. Within the personal mobility side, we still feel there is a lot of uncertainty and a lot of lack of clarity around business models, meaning you could build an OEM potentially in a commercial, in a personal mobility side, meaning you could be a scooter manufacturer or a car manufacturer or I don't know, right, any other personal mobility manufacturer. And I think that space is open. You also need a lot of capital to start up that business. You cannot be a manufacturer by raising $3-5 million. It just doesn't lend itself to a very great investment opportunity in the long run. So we had to find extremely sharp angles to solve for problems given the opportunity that is available today, right? Within that, for us, the key metric, and I think this is one of the more important driving factors for us, was if you really look at why we all care about electric vehicles, it comes down to some innate need that all of us have to move towards non-polluting fuels, right? And if you look at, if you take that as a North Star metric that, hey, I want to really move the fuel consumption mix from, say, gasoline dependent to non-gasoline or cleaner energy mix, personal mobility literally still contributes about, 15% or 20% of fuel consumption. So it is really not the biggest needle mover in terms of the problem statement that that you're trying to solve for, right? Given that North Star metric and given the angles that are available to start a new business and the impact that we can create for customers today, we felt commercial is the way for us to start off. Nothing precludes us from doing anything in the personal mobility space. As a good starting point, commercial vehicle and building a good business model around that commercial vehicles is kind of where we chose to start off.
Right. And in your business, you are touching multiple aspects of commercial vehicle adoption. You're touching financing, you're touching resale also, that very less people talk about today. So can you talk about which all stakeholders are you interacting with and what all pain points are you trying to solve for them?
So which is another key reason why we chose the commercial vehicle segment. The needs of the commercial vehicle buyer are pretty uniform, right? Commercial vehicle is not necessarily somebody's dream vehicle, right? It is a input that goes into a certain business that the individual or a business kind of consumes this vehicle, right? Meaning a commercial vehicle is an input for me to run some other business. I could be a driver come operator, or I could be a small fleet operator who owns, let's say, maybe 1 to 10 vehicles. For me, the vehicle itself is an input, right? And effectively, I always look at the vehicle as a cost parameter. And when you look at the cost of the vehicle, it has to kind of come down to the entire cost of ownership of the vehicle, right? So meaning I own the vehicle so that I can put that vehicle out into some business use. And that's a very clear uniform need across majority of the commercial vehicle owners. Within that, there are three key components. Obviously, how much does it cost to buy the vehicle? And first of all, is the vehicle right for me or not? So somebody has to just kind of help them with that decision. 95% of the people who buy commercial vehicles buy it through financing, right? Like 95%, there is a lot of need for capital to buy commercial vehicles. Again, nobody wants to use equity to go buy a business input metric, which is kind of everybody understands. And more importantly, people also were always very clear and dependent upon a very liquid resale market, so that when the vehicle was out of their usage, for their useful life, they could just go sell the vehicle into second-hand markets and move forward, buy a new vehicle or something else. Right? All of those three problem statements today are not addressed for the commercial vehicle buyer in the EV side, right? Meaning there are multiple vehicles that are available for them at different price points, but buyers are not necessarily clear and sure which vehicle suits their use case, which vehicle doesn't. So there is a clear-cut friction that arises in this buying process for buyers in picking the right vehicle and having the trust in somebody who can actually sell them the right solution in that. So we help them on that side. We help them with buying the right vehicle at the lowest price possible. So they can buy it through our website. They can also use our phone channel to reach out to us, and they can eventually buy the vehicle through us. So that's kind of what we do. We sell electric vehicles at the end of the day, right? But because most of the buyers need financing, we obviously provide financing. But if you look at the financing itself, there are large players in the commercial vehicle financing market in the traditional world who always are dependent upon very liquid resale markets to be able to put good financing products in the market, right? So meaning they gave a good 3-year, 4-year loan to a commercial vehicle buyer at certain levels of interest, which are always pretty high. Given that, they at least had a clear view on what is asset pricing, asset valuation over a lifetime. Now that just ceases to exist in the commercial vehicle EV world, right? Because what is going to happen to the battery after 3 or 4 years? Who will determine the resale value of that? And where will the resale value originate from? So that's one of the core jobs that we do at the company, which is we bridge the automotive use case to other use cases. Like batteries can go into multiple other use cases, right, after they are used in the vehicle. And price can be derived out of those markets and passed on to customers here. So net-net, what we do is we kind of take a view on long-term pricing of battery and pass that on as in the form of a loan to the customer first, and eventually, obviously, as a form of a resale value. So net-net, we bring three key components to the customer. One is partnerships through OEMs, through whom we find the right vehicle for the customer to buy. We also partner with banks and NBFCs to provide loans to our customers. And net-net, we work and kind of help bridge different markets on finding the resale value for the customer and kind of passing that on to the customer, right? So those are the three key stakeholders that we always interact with.
Right. And what is your revenue? Where does your revenue come from? Where are you making money in all of these three steps?
We share profits with banks and NBFCs. Mm-hmm. We share sales commission with OEMs. And we also make money on repurposing the battery. So we have three key revenue streams.
Okay, but the repurposing, of course, wouldn't start very quick, very soon. It would still take time, 3 or 4 years for you to start.
No, there are already a lot of batteries in the market, so we don't have to wait for our own batteries to come back. We can already start that business like now. So we are starting, we have actually already have some pilots going on with a few solar and wind power plants to be able to redeploy auto batteries. So yeah, it's kind of near term, it's not a long term thing.
Okay, all right. And what is the current scale of operations that you're at, and what are your plans for the next, let's say, 1 to 2 years?
Sure. So today, last month, we sold 100 this L5 three-wheel vehicles through our platform. I see data that you guys publish from Vahan. So you know that, like, you know, large companies like Mahindra, Piaggio themselves are at a scale of 200 to 220 per month in terms of their sales, right? So we do already about half of their sales, and end of this month we probably will be close to about 200. Unlike by September we should be close to about 300, 350 vehicles through the platform, right? So these are new demand that we are bringing. So net net with that, we'll be probably a pretty unequivocal largest seller of commercial electric vehicles by September. And we are obviously creating demand for partners like Mahindra, Piaggio, others who work with us, right? So that's one. So I think near-term goal is to consistently sell, and we do this business only in 2 or 3 key cities right now, right? So large OEMs obviously operate across multiple geographies. This is kind of where digital helps us disrupt some of these sales cycles. We do business today. We launched just 2 or 3 geographies just this month. Last month, majority of the business came in like 2 geographies, right? Like Karnataka and Telangana. Within those, we did more businesses, more vehicles than any of these other OEMs. Again, part of it comes down to the product that we are offering to the buyers. Part of it is also the kind of education and the brand that we are building around customers trying to easily, trustworthily move to electric vehicles ultimately, right? So it is all those mean for us that we probably will, and we will continue to focus on three wheels in the near term, because those are the products. We know that good four wheel products are coming into the market in the near term. We are working with those manufacturers at this point in time on creating supply side deals. We definitely will be the largest seller of commercial electric vehicles by September, so which is like next month. Continue to expand more geographies, be a probably a full pan-India player in the next 6 to 9 month horizon. We think we can get to about 1,000 vehicle scale per month by like Jan or Feb of next of this year, which is a pretty sizable shift in the market, right? Like there's like 5x any of the large OEMs were able to do in any single month in their entire life, in the EV side at least. I think that's pretty near term achievable objective from our point of view. In the next 2 years, again, like launching more vehicles, bringing on more financials to the table. Net-net, I think we'll be close to a 35,000 vehicle business by end of December next year. I think that would be a good target to chase from our point of view.
Okay. Okay. And you don't have any physical stores to sell these vehicles. The consulting you're providing is all through phone or through virtual meetings, is it?
Yeah, so it is not actually consulting, right? So ultimately, like if you go to our website, you can find which vehicle today also, which vehicle will suit your needs. So you actually transact. So about 20% of our business comes through people just going through our product and just interacting with our product, right? Some people do still need help in buying the vehicle. So that's where kind of phone comes in. We work with the existing OEMs at the end of the day, right? So we work with the dealers of the existing OEMs in fulfilling the demand. Our job is to convert the demand and then fulfill the demand. We still go to the dealership. We kind of ultimately the vehicle still goes out of build, gets built out of the dealership. So, and we are not going to change that model anytime in the near future.
Okay, understood. And how important is the data collection in supporting your overall business? How are you collecting data and then leveraging it to make your business more efficient?
Obviously, very. That is the key moat at the end of the day. Again, data comes down to two key things. I think there's a lot of talk about, like, you know, what are people use in terms of data on EVs and whatnot. There are a few data points which, like, absolutely have no meaning or whatever. There's limited meaning and everybody will have it, which is geography and whatnot, right? Like, that I think everybody can get. I think the core data sets that here that are that matter is ultimately the big difference between the ICE world and the EV world is that pricing and value of vehicles or assets just doesn't exist, right? Now, we are in the business of putting forward pricing on assets. We are also in the business of taking that forward pricing, meaning the batteries that we will buy in the future, and then kind of putting it in some other markets. So that means that we need to bring more and more confidence into that price points for ourselves so that we can actually pass on more and more value to our customers. So we leverage a lot of the usage data of the battery, the driving patterns, the battery performance itself, the vehicle performance, the use case performance across the life cycle to be able to make that determination in which ways, right? So ultimately, anyway, we are putting the value today, but the more and more data that we get, the value that we put on these assets will continue to keep increasing, right? So that's how we pass on more and more value back to the customer. So data is obviously super important. That's the way we are able to put the best possible value in customers' hands. And that's the way we will eventually drive more sales ultimately here, right? And again, which is why we kind of always felt and we feel that while today commercial vehicles is a good starting point, that same business model can be replicable to other parts of the personal side of mobility as well. And the question is that which exact areas we will want to spend time on. I think that will become clearer over the next 9-12 months. But we all feel that definitely in any value-driven segment, not brand or experience-driven, but pure value-driven segment, and that's kind of 70% of India's market any which way, we'll always have a role to play there in one form or the other.
Right. Okay. But I'm curious to know, how do you collect the data? Because you are not selling the vehicle directly. The dealers,
OEMs, right? So OEMs share the data with us.
Okay. They share the battery usage and pattern data with you.
Yeah. And that's the easiest. Again, we are not a manufacturer, right? So we do not intend to also be a manufacturer in the near term.
Yeah.
Our job is to be more incremental and value added to the OEMs themselves. So we work on top of the infrastructure that the OEMs have. We work on top of the infrastructure the banks and NBFCs have. And we bring value to all of those guys in a very direct way through the pricing that we bring on the asset side.
Okay. And are you solving resale also? I understand that you are, of course, putting a price point for resale, but are you facilitating it also in some way?
Sorry, expand that question. Meaning facilitate, meaning?
Like, for example, if I have a vehicle that has run its course of life and now it has to go into the resale. So for the batteries, I understand you have now collaborations with the solar companies and so on to put batteries into the second use case. But
right.
For example, let's say there is an NBFC that has extended a loan and there is a default on that loan. So in that case, are you facilitating resale or something like that?
No, I think as a new business line itself, no, the answer to that question, not yet. I think that is something that we'll probably do over the next maybe few quarters. But again, that's a new business line altogether. Right now, from a execution point of view, just do not see a lot of value in doing that today.
Okay. And do you in some way help reduce the cost of EV ownership?
Yeah. What is the biggest cost of, if you look at cost of ownership, it's a simple math equation, right? It is, what is the vehicle cost? How much interest I paid during the course of the vehicle? And then when I sell, how much money comes back, the resale value, right? Resale value typically in the ICE world are like, depending on which vehicle, about roughly about 40-50% of the vehicle after 3 to 5 years, right? So that is the biggest component of TCO. And that's exactly what we impact, right, at the end of the day. Today, if we don't exist, some people have to assume much lower resale values, and we impact that value on day one for people. That we give that clarity and confidence to people that on day one, I'll put a big number towards the end of your life cycle, which net brings your overall cost of ownership down by a big factor. I think again, there are other parts, like, you know, in terms of vehicle pricing and the low cost of interest itself, And like even down payments, all of that, we bring much better offering to customers, like, you know, to the market, to the customers in our channels than like people are able to get in the market, right? So net net, we bring the cost of ownership down by about 25-30% like straight on day one for customers.
Okay, understood. Hemant, I think that's all the questions I had. So if there's anything else that you would like to highlight about your company, about your way of working, please, you can add that.
No, I think, see, again, I think like you asked all the right questions, right? I think ultimately what matters in this business, the biggest opportunity in the EV world, ultimately comes down to the ability, not to just collect data, but to use that data to build different types of business models, right? So we definitely have a very unique business model in that sense, which looking at the current circumstantial current circumstances of Indian consumers, especially in the commercial vehicle space, everything that we do kind of is tuned and, like, you know, built around that life cycle of the customer, right? Right from the time of purchase to his end of life needs, and we try to kind of map the customer journey. That's how we kind of organize the business. So I tend to listen. Like, I think, like, we see a lot of value that will get driven because there is more transparency this data will bring into the ecosystem, right? So ultimately we want to be, and we will continue to be, one of those very open players in terms of what does that data mean, and like what are the values, what are the solutions that can be given to the customer through the data. So today we use all of the data that we have, but I think what will end up happening here is that this data will become more open source very fast, right? So not from just from our point, from everybody's point of view. Then the real point is, how can we channelize all of this data into solutions? Could be financing, could be products, could be resale, could be, like, you know, insurance, could be like 100 other things, right? Even businesses, like, you know, literally, like, you know, generating demand for the customer. That is what I think the power of the electric vehicle and the ability for it to be, then given that it is actually a connected vehicle, that it will generate into some of these businesses, right? And I think we're just starting to see what is the first level of disruption that is possible there. I think from Turner's point of view, and, like, you know, others like who work in the ecosystem, the opportunities lie in that. Like, you know, how do you generate more and more use cases for customers, generate more and more value for customers, leveraging the fact that there are certain innate advantages that electric vehicle brings to the table. I think our just conversation across the table is just very, like, you know, high level at this point in time, and all of it is very supply driven, right? Policy should be there, like, whatever, GST rate should be changed, infrastructure should be there. The reality is that none of those are blockers actually for adoption today. Adoption should already happen, and that's what we are starting to see, right? If you put right customer-focused solutions in the market, customers are willing to come and buy. And I think we are already starting to see that through the experiments that Turner has run and kind of now started to establish. So we find it a super exciting time to be in the space, and I'm sure more interesting things are going to just come in the next, you know, 12 months.
Yeah, I definitely agree with you. Okay, so thank you, Hemant. Thanks for taking the time, and it was a very very nice discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.